Until now, I deliberately avoided discussing the topic of confidence scores. When I was discussing SVM, I told you that the classifier can not only give you the human or not human detections, it can also give you a confidence score. That is how confident it is the detection is correct. For example, at this sliding window position, it might say that it is 5% confident that there is a person inside it. That is, the confidence score may not always be between 0 and 100%. It usually varies in between this. Now, when I slide it slightly to the right, the score might increase to 15% because some part of the person is visible here. And at this position, it might be 20 and so on. If you go on filling the scores for the first row, it might look like this. So this way, at most places in the image, the confidence scores will be very low, except near the vicinity of this person. At this sliding window position, the confidence score might be around 70%. Slightly to the right, it might be 75. And then it'll start reducing to 70, 65, and so on. One row down, it might increase to 80, then 85. Then here it's around 80, and so on. At this position, it'll be 90. Here it's highest at 95. Here again, it'll start going down to 90 and so on. So near the vicinity of this person, if you look at the confidence score table, it might look like this. Now, by looking at this table, how do I decide which are the locations that are valid and which locations are invalid? That is, what is the confidence score threshold that I have to select so that only the valid bounding boxes are selected? It's no-brainer here. I can just use a confidence score threshold of 95% and select only the correct bounding box and ignore all the others. This definitely would work in this case, but what happens if I try the same approach on some other image? Let's see. Here for this image, we can say that this person will be detected correctly because he might have more than 95% confidence score. But we can see that there are other people in the image who are not very clearly visible. So for these people, the confidence score might be very less, let's say around 70%. So if I use a very high threshold of 95%, I'll be missing these detections. That is, it's clearly a case of false negatives. Now at the other extreme, what happens if I choose a confidence score threshold of say 30%? In this case, I might end up with some false positives. That is, in these windows, there are no humans, but still my classifier will say that there is a person inside it. So as we have seen in the first chapter, this is a classic case of trade-off between sensitivity and specificity. If you use a very low confidence score, your sensitivity will be high, but specificity will be low. As you go on increasing the confidence score to around 95%, your sensitivity will go down, but specificity will increase. So we have to carefully select a specific confidence score so that we achieve a good trade-off between these two values. Now let's say by considering all these factors, I set a confidence score threshold of 70%. That is, anything above this, I'll be considering it as a true positive. Now if I take this approach, I'll be still left with some duplicate detections. That is, for this person, only the red box corresponding to a score of 95% is correct. And all other boxes, the yellow ones, are all duplicates for the same person. Now, how will I remove all the duplicates? One simple idea would be to just select the red box and see what are all the boxes that are overlapping it. In this case, all the yellow boxes overlap the red ones. So I can straight away remove them. So this is codified in this algorithm. The same technique I will apply on top of all the people in both the images, and I will be able to retain only the red boxes and remove all the yellow ones. So this technique should work just fine. Except that it has a problem in few cases. Let's consider this image and apply the same algorithm. Here, I will select the box with the highest confidence score, that happens to be this green one, and remove all the boxes that are overlapping it. That is, I'll remove these blue boxes, but not only that, I will also end up removing the yellow and red ones. So the problem here is that these yellow and red boxes belong to some other person. But with the intention of removing the duplicates, I also removed even the boxes pertaining to some other person. So this algorithm has a problem that it does not work that well when the objects are close to each other because their bounding boxes overlap. How do I refine this algorithm? One observation here is that If you look at the area of overlap between the green and blue boxes, it is high. But the area of overlap between the green and the yellow and red boxes are low. By using the amount of overlap as the criteria, I'll be able to selectively remove only those boxes that have high amount of overlap with the green box. Now, how do I mathematically measure how much is the overlap between two different bounding boxes? As we have already seen in the second chapter, I can use this metric called intersection over union. Now, what I will do, I will set a IOU threshold of 70% and repeat this algorithm. Now, what will happen? I'll first select this green box with the 85% confidence score, and I'll remove these two blue boxes which have a high IOU overlap. Next, I have to rerun this process until all the boxes are done. That is, now I'll select this red box and remove the yellow ones. So this way, I'll be able to remove all the duplicate bounding boxes and retain only the correct ones. So this completes my object detection pipeline. At the input side, to tackle the problem of location, that is, the object can be present at any location in the image, I'm using a sliding window technique. And to account for different scales of the object, I'm using image pyramid. And at the output side, to remove all the invalid detections, I'm using a confidence score threshold. Even after doing that, I'll be having some duplicate detections. This I'll be removing by using the IOU threshold. This technique is called Non Max Suppression. So this completes my object detection pipeline with HOG and SVM. In the next video, I'll be discussing an improvement on top of this algorithm called Deformable Parts Model.